गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन. येस्टरडे यू हैव सीन ट्रांसपोर्टेशन इन केस ऑफ प्लांट्स, राइट? सो वॉट ऑल यू हैव सीन, वॉट ऑल फैक्टर्स यू हैव सीन इन केस ऑफ प्लांट्स, विच टू फैक्टर्स आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर अपवर्ड पुल ऑफ वाटर? येस, रूट प्रेशर इज वन थिंग एंड द अदर फैक्टर दैट यू हैव सीन इज, येस, वॉट इज द अदर फैक्टर अपार्ट फ्रॉम रूट प्रेशर? रूट प्रेशर इज एप्लीकेबल फॉर वेरी वेरी स्मॉल प्लांट्स. But if the plant is really very heighted one, or if it is very very tall, then which factor dominates over there? So transpirational pool, as you can see over here, the leaves are losing the water, okay, through its stomata. And what happens is when the leaves start losing the water, can you comment about the water concentration in the upward part of the plant? Will it be low or high if the leaves are losing lot of water molecules? So the concentration of water molecule in the topmost part will be what? Low or high? It will be low. Okay. Then what about roots? You are continuously, or you are also planting, you are also providing water to the plants or water to the trees. So what is the water concentration over here? High. Now you know that what is the movement of water molecule from high concentration area to low concentration area. So transpirational pool helps to create a suction pump. Okay, it helps to create a suction which pulls the water from the root to the leaf. Okay, this is one thing that you have studied yesterday, and the rest was regarding translocation. Translocation is the term when we use when we are talking about transportation of food and other substances. Then we use this term translocation. Just like xylem is helping in the transportation of water and minerals. In this case, phloem is helping in the transportation of the food materials. Okay, and for the transportation of food materials, ATP is required. What do you mean by ATP? ATP is nothing but adenosine triphosphate, which is also called as energy currency of the cell. Okay, so ATP is required for translocation. Whenever you see this word translocation, that means it is the transportation of soluble products of photosynthesis. And you know what is the product of photosynthesis? Nothing but glucose, right? One more thing about this translocation is, suppose if this is a tree, okay, just a rough diagram, and if suppose if this is a leaf, you know that leaves prepare food for the plant. So can you comment about concentration of food material in the leaf, whether it will be high or low? In the upper part of the plant, it will be high, okay. Rest of the plant, what will be the concentration of the food and other substances? It will be low. So if the food material will move from a region of high concentration area to the region of low concentration area, and this is how the food will be distributed to each and every part of the plant cell, okay, and phloem components will be used for it. Okay, so now today we will be starting with transportation in humans, how humans perform this process of transportation, or which part of the body performs the transportation. What helps things in our body go from one place to another within our body? Which thing helps when you have to transport something inside your body? What is the that thing that will help? Blood. Very good. What is blood? It is basically a connective tissue, a liquid which has cells, dissolved gases, waste from cells, nutrition for the cells, etc. Everything, oxygenated thing, deoxygenated thing, waste materials, dissolved gases, nutrients, everything. Let's take a detailed look at the system which helps blood flow all around the body and what other functions this system does. Now, blood flows through tubes or blood vessels that you have already studied in your lower classes. There are three types: arteries, veins, and capillaries. Now, what pushes the blood, makes it move? What, which organ or which thing is providing that push to the blood so that it keeps on transporting the minerals, it keeps on transporting the necessary things to all parts of the body? Correct, heart. The heart, blood vessels, and the blood together forms a system. What is that system known as? What is that system also known as? Circulatory system. Very good. Let us look at the roles and responsibilities of this system. So, circulatory system, responsibilities, and what all organs are concerned. Responsibility is transportation and obviously self repair. When you have cuts, when you have wound, then you may see what you can see. You can see platelets. They are trying to clog that particular wound. Then under transportation, these all things need to be transported, like nutrients, waste, gases, cells. Okay. What are the organs of our circulatory system? We have the heart and our blood vessels. Blood vessels carry the blood from the heart to rest of the body. In case if it is oxygenated blood, then it has to be transported from the heart to rest of the body. And once your body utilizes that oxygenated blood, it will definitely give some waste product, and that waste product should be again brought back to the heart and then to the lungs for oxygenation purpose. This is basically a rough idea I am trying to give you how the cycle works. The heart pumps out blood with oxygen to the whole body, and also it collects blood without oxygen. The blood that is without oxygen is called as deoxygenated blood. Okay, D means removal. Okay, D means removal from the rest of the body. Now you can read that last line again. The heart pumps out blood with oxygen to the whole body and collects blood without oxygen from the rest of the body. Now, how does the blood without oxygen become blood with oxygen? You have seen it under respiration. Where does this process take place? How does the blood without oxygen, that is basically a deoxygenated blood, becomes blood with oxygen? Very good, Ulas. It is under alveoli, balloon-like structures. No, a heart is pumping organ. It will not purify. It will only pump. But for purification purpose, you need to send it to lungs, and to be more precise, where in lungs? It has to be in alveoli, balloon-like structures, sac-like structures. Okay, that happens in the lungs, and you know how gaseous exchange happens in the alveoli. We know how the surface area of alveoli helps in efficient exchange of gases. So we can think of blood like this: heart, then organs. So this is basically a block diagram. Now the red part you can see, you can consider it the blood with oxygen, and the blue lines or the blue part that you are seeing, you can consider blood without oxygen. Okay, remember this. We know that cells in our body use the oxygen and glucose to make energy, and how CO2 is a waste gas that the lungs give out. This we have already seen in respiration. Now let us see how our heart works and how it manages to keep the blood with oxygen and blood without oxygen separate from each other. Now what will happen? Suppose if heart has to give out oxygen, if heart has to transport oxygenated blood, it will transport that oxygenated blood to the organs. Okay, definitely there will be some vessels. We are going to study that. Now once the organs will utilize that oxygenated blood, they will release the waste product in the form of CO2. Again, the blood-rich in CO2 will come. It will give it to the heart. The heart will give that O2 deficient blood or deoxygenated blood to the lungs again for purification purpose. Did you understand this cycle? How is this cycle going on? Oxygenated blood will be given by heart to organs. Then organ will release certain waste product in the form of CO2. That CO2 will be brought by the blood. It will be again given to heart, and from heart it will go to lungs for purification purpose. Okay. Our heart actually has two main parts separated by wall. This keeps blood with oxygen and without oxygen separate from each other. There should not be intermixing of blood. Otherwise, what will happen now? The energy requirements which our body needs, that will not be fulfilled. That is why it is very important that our heart should have partitions. So again, this is a block diagram. If you look at yourself in the mirror, the left and the right gets interchanged. What is also known as what is that term in which the left and right gets interchanged? Laterally inverted image, you call it, right? Yes. So in the same way, mark the left and right side here. So this will become left, this will become right. Each half is further divided into two parts, but these parts are connected to each other. So think of it as something like this. So these partitions which you can see in the middle is nothing but walls. Valves, walls. Okay. The upper part are called atrium and the lower part are called ventricles. Let's name each part. So over here you can see it is left atrium, left ventricle. Over here, you can see right atrium and right ventricle. The upper part are atrium and the lower part are ventricle. Now, the blood that comes into heart comes into atrium like this. Okay. From the atrium, the blood flows. See, not to confuse you all, but now till now also we are going to have a rough overview. We have not got into that detail. Okay. We are going to do that detail subsequently, but this diagram also talks about how roughly the transportation takes place. So atrium is basically those chambers of heart which will receive the blood. Okay. Now from the atrium, the blood will go to ventricles, obviously. From the ventricles, the blood exits the heart. So you can see these two downward arrows, right? Can the blood go in reverse direction from ventricle to the atrium? What do you think? Can the blood go from reverse direction? Like if the blood is coming from atrium to ventricle, be it right atrium to right ventricle or let it be left atrium to left ventricle, can it go reverse? Why? Why it cannot go reverse? Yes, because of the wall. As soon as the blood enters from atrium to ventricle, it cannot go back because the walls get closed. Okay. Not at all, because between the atrium and the ventricles, we have walls like this. You can think of these walls as loose flaps. When the blood flows down, they are open like this. If the blood tries to go from ventricle to atrium, the blood flow will push the wall shut and the blood can't go that way, like this. So if it is trying to go back now, if you can see this upward arrow, if the blood tries to go back, the walls get closed and this particular thing doesn't happen. So for MCQ, they can give you certain statements like which of the following is a function of wall or which of the following is not a function of wall. So it prevents the backflow of blood, that you should remember. That is the function of a wall, to allow flow only in one direction, like this. The right side of the heart collects blood from all over the body, that is blood without oxygen, that is also known as deoxygenated blood. So which part of the heart will collect deoxygenated blood, whether it will be right atrium or left atrium? Yes, if deoxygenated blood is there, then it should come to right atrium, right? So like this, if you remember, we used blue notations for blood without oxygen. When we saw that block diagram, it was written like blue is blood without oxygen and red is blood with oxygen. So this was written. The left side of the heart sends blood all over the body. So that is the blood with oxygen, oxygenated blood. So now they have used red color arrow. Okay, so left atrium receives oxygenated blood, right atrium receives deoxygenated blood, like this. Let's just use short forms for the names of the chambers of the heart now. So they have used RA symbol for right atrium, RV for right ventricle, LA for left atrium, and LV for left ventricle. Now, actually, there are two veins that bring blood from the whole body to the heart. So one is superior vena cava and the other one is inferior vena cava. Now, see. You know that the right part of the heart carries which type of blood? Just now we have discussed. Right part of the blood, heart carries which type of blood? Whether it is deoxygenated or oxygenated, it is deoxygenated. Now there should be some blood vessels, right? Who should bring that deoxygenated blood from your whole body and it should give it to the right atrium. So which are those blood vessels? Those are superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. The name superior indicates that these blood vessels will only be responsible for bringing the deoxygenated blood from the upper part of the body. That is why superior. If the deoxygenated blood has to be brought from the lower part of the body, like legs and thighs and all things like that, then the blood vessel that will be responsible will be inferior vena cava, therefore the term inferior. So you can remember like this. Superior means upper part of the body and inferior means the lower part of the body. Okay. Now, when the blood exits the heart from RV means right ventricle, where do you think it goes? So, superior and inferior vena cava will bring deoxygenated blood. They will give it to right atrium. Right atrium will apply some pressure. The valves will get open. The deoxygenated blood will go to right ventricle. From right ventricle, where should this deoxygenated blood go? Should it go back to all the body parts? Then what is the use? It is a deoxygenated blood, na? Yes. So again, it has to be sent to the lungs for purification for oxygenation. Now, what does this blood need? Oxygen. So it will go to the lungs. And who does that job? Who does the job of carrying the deoxygenated blood from right ventricle to lung? It is done by pulmonary artery. Remember all the blood vessels. Anything could be asked for MCQ. Okay. Once the lungs take away CO2 and add O2 to that blood, where will it go? Now the deoxygenation part is over. We have given the deoxygenated blood to the lungs. The pulmonary artery has given it to the lungs. Now the lungs have added O2 to that blood. Now the blood has become oxygenated. So where it should go now? Oxygenated blood. Very good. It should come to left atrium. Very good. When the blood gets O2 from the lungs, it comes back to the heart, to the left atrium. Again, it will go to left ventricle. One more thing. Pulmonary vein is that particular blood vessel which will bring the oxygenated blood from the lungs to the right, to the left atrium. Okay, so the blood vessel will be pulmonary vein. Then from left atrium, you have MCQ, so there is no need for drawing a diagram. They will print this diagram, or they will ask you to find out what is meant by A, what is meant by B. Or suppose if they will draw this block diagram, they will just mention an arrow and they will ask which blood vessel is responsible for bringing the blood from this side of the body to that side of the body. Like that, they will ask. Now, the oxygenated blood from left atrium will go to left ventricle. Now, this is an oxygenated blood. So, from left ventricle, where it should go? Remember, it is an oxygenated blood. So, from left ventricle, where should this blood go? Should it go back to the lungs? Then what is the use? It is already oxygenated. It should go to all parts of the body. Very good. It should go to all parts of the body. And which blood vessel is responsible for doing this particular job? Doing this particular job means to transport the oxygenated blood from left ventricle to all parts of the body. It is aorta. Okay, A-O-R-T-A, aorta. Right? So is this clear, the whole cycle? Where from where the blood is coming, where blood is going, the oxygenated blood is going where, oxygenated blood is going where, which blood vessels are responsible, everything. Yes. You can embed this particular block diagram in your mind so that you know that if in MCQ, if any question comes, you can ultimately retrieve the information from the brain that it was pulmonary vein that was bringing it from lungs to left atrium. On the upper part, it was superior and inferior vena cava, where it was bringing the deoxygenated blood from the upper part of the body or lower part of the body and giving it to right atrium. So you can embed this particular block diagram in your brain. Okay? And that is how the heart is. So this is something what is also given in the NCRT, if you look. Whatever we have seen it in detail. Yes, this particular diagram. Schematic sectional view of the human heart. Okay, this cycle we have already seen just now using the PPT in the form of block diagram. Also, there are some sheets that you have got from the school. That sheet also contains the mind map for circulatory system. So you can refer that also. Okay. What is septum? Septum is basically a dividing wall, a wall that separates the left part of the heart from the right part of the heart. Okay, rest all things we have already seen. Please go through the exercise questions just for your clarity so that you get to know whether I've understood the main concept or not. Now look at the figures of the heart and try to spot all these things in it. So how can the question be designed? Maybe they will print this particular diagram that is given in your NCRT and they will not label it. Huh? They will not label it. Suppose they will not label it, they will write it as A, they will write it as B, C, D, and they will ask you how is the sequential flow of blood takes place. So they will give you four options, and in the four options they will design the flow chart, left atrium to left ventricle to all part of the body like this. So this kind of flow chart can also be asked. Okay, now this we have already seen. Now you also know how our heart works and also how blood flows. So this is something that you have seen: arteries, veins. Blood vessels that carry blood away from the heart are called arteries. Now, if the blood is going away from the heart, can you comment about oxygenation or deoxygenation, whether that blood will be oxygenated or deoxygenated if it is going away from the heart? Yes, it is oxygenated. There is one exception in the artery which doesn't carry oxygenated blood. What is the name of that artery? Yes, pulmonary artery. Very good. Similarly, blood vessels that carry blood to the heart are called veins. These are basically the deoxygenated blood. But again, there is an exception, that is pulmonary vein, which carries the oxygenated blood. Okay, so remember all these one-liners for MCQ. And there is just one vein which does not carry blood with CO2, that is this pulmonary vein. Okay, the heart pumps blood into arteries. Now, when the blood flows through the arteries, right, the pressure is very, 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 very high. To sustain that high pressure, arteries have thick walls. When blood flows through veins to come back to the heart, the pressure is very low. So, veins do not have thick walls. But in the lower body, the blood is traveling against the gravity to come back to the heart. So, it may happen that the blood flow can be reversed back. Now, in order to prevent that, veins have walls. They need that to stop the blood from flowing in the reverse direction, in the direction of gravity. Because from your lower part of the body, it has to travel to the heart, which is situated in the upper part of the body. That is against the gravity. Okay. Now, it may happen that blood can go in the reverse direction. So, to prevent that, veins have walls. Arteries do not have walls. Because in arteries, already the pressure is very, very high. There is no chance of reversing back. Right? That way our heart is, you can see that blood with O2 and blood with CO2 doesn't mix. Why is mixing not required? Because we need our heart to be that way, because our energy requirement is very, very high. So if someone asks you, or if in the question it is like, why are there four chambers in human beings, in case of mammals, you know? So you have to answer like, having four chambers ensures no mixing of blood takes place. Oxygenation blood is separated from deoxygenated, and when it is separated, then only our energy requirement can be met. Suppose if O2 rich blood mixed with CO2 rich blood, then the energy produced is very, very low and it cannot meet the requirement of a mammal. Okay, in case of human beings also. It's high because our body has to keep working to maintain its temperature. We are warm-blooded animals. That is why. That is also one of the reasons. Warm-blooded creatures like humans, mammals, and birds have heart like this. Reptiles and amphibians have three-chambered hearts, and somewhat mixing is allowed over there because they do not perform that level of activity. So it's okay over there. Okay. Can you give an exception in case of reptiles where it has four-chambered hearts? You have studied it under 9th, diversity of living organisms under kingdom Animalia. Yes. So in case of crocodile, they have four chambered of heart, but rest of them have three chambered. Yes, there is some mixing takes place, but that is okay because they do not require high amounts of energy. Similarly, Pisces, which includes all the fishes, they have only two chambered. So again, there is a lot of mixing, but that is again okay because they are not not that very active, or they do not require that much energy. So that is okay in their case, but not okay in our case, right? With this, we end the this thing, transportation. I will come back to pulmonary and all this thing right now only. Please go through this yellow box. This is for your extra information. What is blood pressure? What is systolic pressure? What is diastolic pressure? What is the normal range of BP? 80/120. 80 stands for diastolic or systolic. 120 stands for diastolic or systolic, etc. Okay. And which instrument you use for measuring the blood pressure? For MCQ, I am asking. So this is sphygmomanometer. What will happen if there is high blood pressure and things like that? What is the role of platelets? Basic thing, please read this chapter. You will come to know what is the function of platelets. You know that whenever there is a cut, whenever there is a wound, whenever there is a leakage, platelets, they have to ensure that the leakage doesn't take place. So they come at a site and they provide the patch just like this. Yeah, so suppose if this is the case, the leaking starts. First of all, your blood vessel shrinks. That makes less blood leak out. The platelets stick together around the wound to patch the leak. This forms a patch to stop the bleeding. Once a blood clot has closed the wound, the surrounding blood vessels can deliver fresh nutrients to help the wound heal. Okay, so this is the function of platelets. Rest you can read from the NCERT. What I want to explain you is important thing about double circulation, pulmonary circulation, and systemic circulation. So we will go back to that. You can write these things because these things are not mentioned in the book that clearly. I mean, the terminologies are not mentioned. So you can write these. So pulmonary circulation, I'm writing it as PC, pulmonary circulation. Now, what is pulmonary circulation? In this circulation, the deoxygenated blood is pushed by the right ventricle to the lung for oxygenation through pulmonary artery, and then the oxygenated blood is brought back to left atrium. What is happening is, see, deoxygenated blood, okay, is pushed from right ventricle to the lung. Okay, now once it is given to lungs will purify that blood, and now the blood will become O2 rich. Okay, now this O2 rich blood will come to left atrium via which vein? Yes, which vein? Pulmonary vein. So this is nothing but pulmonary circulation. Okay, this cycle is of pulmonary circulation. What is systemic circulation? So in systemic circulation, the oxygenated blood that is brought to the left atrium goes to the left ventricle and it is passed to all the body parts. So systemic circulation means the O2 rich blood which is there now, it goes from left atrium to left ventricle. And from left ventricle, it is distributed to all the body parts via the artery. Okay, so this is a cycle for systemic circulation. And the cycle that I've explained is for pulmonary circulation. Is this clear? Systemic means when the distribution of blood is taking place to the body, and pulmonary circulation is regarding the deoxygenated blood. Now, can you comment that in one cycle, how many times the blood is traveling to your heart? In one cycle, how many times the blood is traveling through your heart? Two times. That is why it is called as double circulation. एक बार तो वो ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड ला रही है एंड दूसरी बार वो डीऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड ला रही है और दोनों भी बारी हार्ट के थ्रू इट इज गोइंग एंड इट इज मूविंग, सो दैट इज वाई इट इज डबल सर्कुलेशन. So PC, that means pulmonary circulation plus systemic circulation gives you double circulation. Is this clear?
If you like our videos, do share them and subscribe to our channel. If you want awesome quizzes, write to us. Keep watching and keep learning with Walnut.